Hey everybody, this is Derek Rosebrock from DrummerConnection.com. I'm in Richmond, Virginia. I'm hanging out with my friend Jason Truda, and he invented the True Tuner. And he's going to kind of take us through his journey today on how he invented it. He's going to show us some of his old prototypes, which I was blown away when he showed me these things. So, and we're also going to talk about, you know, filing patents and getting your product to distribution. And he's going to kind of share his story with us. So, Jason, thanks for having me in your living room, man. This is really
absolutely
cool. This is total drum geek to the core right here, you know. It's like we're down in the pits and we're messing with drums. We have this really cool Dunnett drum here we're going to kind of demo the True Tuner with. And so let me get to it. Where did this idea come from to create this disc that you put on top of your drum and it changes the drum head, you know, loosens all the tension rods at the same time? And where did this come from?
Well, basically, 15 years ago when I was sitting at a drum set for the first time, getting ready to change the drum head, I went to put the key on and started to do it. And then basically I was like, this just doesn't seem right. I'm going to go to the store and buy the thing that does it all. So I went to the store, checked the internet, couldn't find anything. And about 12 years later, still nothing came out, so I figured I'd start looking into ways that it could be done and then designing it as well. So we got into it that way.
Now, have you had any kind of mechanical engineering background? Because this is pretty interesting how this works.
No, basically just a business degree.
Just a degree in business. So
yeah,
you've got the business stuff figured out. Where did the mechanical inspiration come from? I mean, I know that you're trying to solve a problem.
Well, I was frustrated with the technique, and sometimes frustration will drive you to find a solution. So
right on.
What I tried to do, and
cool.
Pretty sure I've done.
All right, so for those who haven't seen the True Tuner, I personally demoed it. You know, I've done two videos on it. I did the first review of it, and then I also filmed you guys at NAMM doing it. Samantha
right.
was doing it, you know, operating the True Tuner. So run us through what it's like right now, and then we'll go back and we'll show the revisions of it. How about that?
All right.
So let's pull out the production model, the one that you guys can buy right now. We're going to stick it on top of this Dunnett drum, and Jason's going to show us how it's done. So
basically, here's what it is. It does anything from 8 to 16 inch, does all different lug patterns. It's color coded, so it's easy to line up. And pretty much, it comes with 10 keys in a bag. Then once you get it, you take the keys out, you set them all on the drum, and you want to put them in the same direction. And the purpose of this is to change the head and get you to a great starting point to fine tune. And I'll explain everything as we go along here. But once you get them all on there.
Before you change anything, let me just tap the drum so you guys can see where it's at right now. Now, we were checking this a little while ago with iDrumTech. It's around a 349, 350 hertz. So let's see where you can get it after you True-tuner it.
So basically what you're doing is you're offsetting the circle so it lines up with these holes for each diameter.
And this is a 13-inch drum.
This is a 13-inch drum, so you want them all facing the same direction. So now they're all pretty much facing that way. Then what you do is you pop the handle up, you go to what size you're going to be doing, and you start with the number each time. So you put it on the 13, and now that they're all facing the same direction, they line up and fall into the holes pretty easy. And if you need to adjust them, just turn them to the side.
All right, now stop. Before anybody freaks out, because we're doing this to a Dunnett snare drum, I firmly believe in this True Tuner product, okay? This is not a sales commercial, but everybody knows this is like the Bentley of snare drums right here, and I trust True Tuner because I've used it like several times on like six or seven of my drums. I know it works. All right, go ahead.
So
just throw that disclaimer.
No, absolutely.
Yeah.
It's
all right.
The best drum out. So basically what you do when you're taking off a drum head, especially on a snare, you have high tension. So what you're going to do is with all the drum keys facing this way, pointing that way, you put one hand here and use your hand against the disc to break it loose.
And you're holding the snare over here, the actual drum, to kind of stabilize it, right?
Right. You hold it to get pressure to help push the disc and all the keys because they're all facing one direction. So all that torque builds up and you can push from the disc, then it goes easy. And once it's loosened up, you loosen it up, and you can pick up the system with the rim.
I get all that stick dust out of there. Thanks, dude. And I'll just get to look at the inside of this drum because I haven't done this yet. All right, I'm done.
You can set it down either upside down, it'll stay, or you can set it.
Do me a favor.
Just like that.
There you go. I'm gonna put the logo this way, so.
Okay. So then basically what you wanna do is line the lugs up one by one. Once you get a couple of them in there, you can let go with one hand, and you just hold it with the other. Then if some of them pop out, what you do is you just push up and then set it back in there. Then you want to double check that they're all sitting in there. And so there's no risk of double threading or cross threading, anything like that. You take it back a half turn so they all sit evenly. Then you want to give it a go. And once they start going, you can increase the speed. And what it's doing is you're all familiar with the star tuning pattern where you're stretching one side then the other. The object of that is to get the head as evenly stretched as possible. Now this is doing everything all at one time, stretching evenly at the same rate, so your head's going to be stretched completely even to provide a close to even tone all the way across while near perfect tension at each point because everything's moving at the same rate. So once you get the drum kind of tight with the snare, you want to give it a little push just like you loosened it, going this way while holding the drum. You put your hand here, they're all facing that way. You push it, and you'd move your hand over here. And that's to get the higher tension for that real tight feel on the snare drum.
Now, you wouldn't necessarily need to do that on a tom,
but no.
Yeah, just give it a little nudge.
Yeah, with the toms, you just, once it tightens up, it's usually pretty good. And then you can just take this, set it down. And like I said at the beginning, the purpose of this is to change a head quickly and take out the tedious work of spinning one at a time. Or sometimes if you use a drill bit, it's great, it's quick, but then it doesn't provide a good starting point and can still stretch the head or bend a rim or warp your shell. With this, the rim's applying even pressure all the way around, so it's not gonna warp your shells. You can't over tighten because all the tension of each one builds up.
Visually, you can, you know, usually whenever you have a drum tension, you can look at the gap from the top of the head to the, you know, the ring all the way around of the hoop, and it looks like it's dead on. I mean, no sides are sagging lower, is what I'm trying to say, or
right.
Deeper. So.
And you're not going to find really any of the wavy areas, that soft spots sometimes you can miss when you do a quick change, because this is stretching it evenly. And what that is it's where it's not as tight as the other side. When everything goes at the same rate, it applies the same pressure all the way down and stretches it evenly. So you're going to be close to a even tension all the way around, which is going to provide a pretty close to perfect tone on it. But then once it's already off, you have your keys set into place so you can fine tune everything to your specific. So the purpose of this is not to take away from tuning by ear using an iDrum Tech or any tuning mechanism that you currently do. This is just to get you a great starting point quickly. And so
I can testify that, you know, changing a head if you mess up, you could spend a half an hour trying to tune that one head, but having it perfectly cleared, you know, it's. It's on. And we can. It's on. So let's talk about, you know, the idea. How did you come to the disc? of True Tuner. I mean, I see a couple little really interesting prototypes over here. And when this idea first came to mind, what are some of the pains you went through in designing this system?
Well, pretty much it didn't start out like a disc at all. It was me drawing on pieces of paper what looked like kind of double bass arms that stretched in and out, that worked through kind of gears. And actually, this was the very first prototype here.
It looks like a helicopter, or like a UFO.
You know, we started working on the design and everything, and figured gears would be the best way to do it. And so what we did was we went out, and there's a main gear on the bottom here that has a 45 degree angle where you spin it. These gears have 45 degree angles, so you spin that.
Oh, wow.
And it spins the arms, but then these arms have the same type of system here with the gear that turns when the arm turns and then turns this, so you can turn it this way, and if you were to set it on a drum, it would go.
It would actually turn the head. It would turn
the tension rods all at the same time based on the gear.
Okay.
And there could have been some variances with the gears, one being at a different point or lining up. But when I was designing this, I wanted something that would be universal, so you could use it on any drum, whether you bought it 20 years ago or if you bought it yesterday. And drums have different size lug patterns, so I wanted something that was truly universal. And with this system, there's so many moving parts, so many possibilities for failure, and it couldn't be really, I guess you could design it, but it just wouldn't be cost effective for anybody to be able to use it when there's so much cost involved, so many moving parts, possibilities for failure. So I kept looking and kept looking and coming up with different designs. So I actually went to Home Depot and grabbed a wire spool with no wire, asked them if I could have one, and they said, sure, take it. And I was like, I'm working
like
on something.
Bigger one?
Yeah, like a big wire spool for construction wire. Okay. And I took like a speed key, and I drilled two holes, and I put one on each side.
Okay.
And I was working with my brother in his workshop, trying to come up with something here. And we put two holes on it to test to see, well, why wouldn't it work the same when you have a hole on each side of the diameter? Just move the point of contact around, and then you put it on. And then we looked at each other and was like, you know, it works.
Wow.
So
now you have an idea for one that has two. You have a prototype working for two keys, or two drum rods, tension rods.
Right.
How did the patterns evolve into the disc, if you will?
Right. So with the two, we figured, why wouldn't it work for 3, 4, 5, 6, any other number? So what we did from that point is we made, when you design something and you have an idea, it's called a breadboard, where it's just a rough prototype to see, you know, what, if it'll work, if it's a basic concept that could work if you design it finer. So we took standard drum patterns, measured them out, different diameters, and took a piece of wood and cut them all in there and drew the lines on it. And this is kind of, you know, the dartboard or whatever.
Yeah.
We came up with, and we tested it, and it seemed to work.
That's pretty wild. So then this became, where'd you go from here?
This is where we started looking more into design and got with the design firm on how to make a production model that we could really test. So from here, we went and had a clear sheet cut of acrylic and drilled the patterns and everything, and started to use it, and It wasn't as user-friendly as we wanted. It did the job great, but we wanted something that anybody could use and use easily.
It's pretty sturdy, so it doesn't flex or anything, right?
No, it's very tough material, but what we wanted to do was make a product that was affordable for most drummers, and when you're using a thick sheet like this, this is what helping with talking with the design firm of engineers. They helped us come up with a way that you could minimize the material while maximizing strength.
Buying giant sheets.
So instead of having a thick, heavy piece, you can have a thicker piece with ridges and valleys in it that provide the same strength and flex as this and durability, but minimizing the cost so it doesn't transfer over to the end user.
Okay.
So what we did from there, we had a prototype cut.
Wow.
And this is actually from our mold. They made it from clay as a test shot for us to look at.
Oh, wow.
Beforehand. And right about the same time, we had them custom make one where they CNC machined everything. And as you can see, there's ridges and valleys. And what we learned from this process is that it minimizes the weight, but it still provides the same strength, because an I-beam type form like this is has the same strength as a solid piece. So you're minimizing the material, but still maximizing the strength. And you can.
Yeah. All right. It's very steady. So is this your first handle prototype?
First handle prototype didn't fold.
Really?
What we wanted to do was make something as a drummer that went on the road and knows how easily things can break and everything. Having something that stuck out like this, we saw potential for it easy to break or to snap at this point. And we wanted to design something that was a product that would not only do the job right, but last, because the last thing anybody wants to do is buy a cheap product that you have to keep buying over and over. You might as well pay a little bit more to make sure that you have something that a company's going to stand behind and offer a lifetime warranty with, because we know that we've made a product that's going to last.
Right. And it folds up and it can fit in your snare drum bag or even your cymbal bag, right?
Yeah, it just folds down. It's got a spring where you just lift up and drop it down, so it'll fit in your soft cymbal bag. And even if you want it to fit in your hard cymbal case, you can just unscrew.
Oh, cool.
That, and then you can take the handle and put it in the bag with your keys, and this fits on the bottom of your
yeah.
cymbal case.
See,
with the spine running through it.
I didn't even know that. That's pretty cool.
Then we also made the nut recessed on it, mm-hmm. so that if you're using it on your snare and you go to set it on your floor tom,
it doesn't punch your head.
It doesn't punch through and damage the head. And also for the fact that if you set it on the floor and you're at a show and your guitarist or somebody walks by and steps on it, it's completely flat.
Okay.
So it's not going to have a point that's going to apply pressure that could break the disc.
Cool.
So that's what we did there. And then this was first prototype out of the mold, and it, when working with the clear plastic, which it's made out of the same stuff as bulletproof glass, they have to adjust the mold to make sure that it's perfectly clear, because it's heating and cooling and a couple other things involved.
So by this time you'd already had a patent, right?
Right.
Okay, we're going to talk about the patent process here after you finish demoing your process of having. What after this one? What was next?
Right after this, we went to SummerNAMM to test it out and see what people thought in the public. We tested in smaller markets and stores with drummers, and consistently the feedback was great and that they liked it, and so we wanted to take it to the next step and get a further evaluation and a bigger market impression on it.
You've gone through the process of developing and going through several revisions and then taking it to a design firm to have it refined and give you some great ideas on how to get it molded and all that stuff. You also applied for a patent.
Right.
What was that process like? Because I know there's a lot of guys out there coming up with ideas, and they're like, should I patent it, or should I not patent it, or how do I patent it? So right. Can you give us a little bit of business insight on that?
Yeah, absolutely. Start to finish, so far, it's taken about 4 years. But once I had the idea, what I did from there is that you don't want to be wasting your time. You want to make sure that if your idea is valid and that you can determine that there's a market for it, basically the smartest thing that you can do once you get the idea and want to take the next step to turning an idea into an actual product is getting with a patent attorney and having them do a prior art search. And what that does is it has the patent attorney go through all types of similar patents or something that it could infringe upon and make your product invalid. So if you have an idea but somebody has a patent on something but hasn't done anything with it, they can still protect their intellectual property. Okay. So if you want to invent a drumstick, but there's a patent on a drumstick, but nobody ever invented it, what they're doing is they're going to search to make sure that it's a clear market and you're not overlapping anybody else's rights.
Okay. So when you got I see your patent up here, the official patent, right? So you get this cool little booklet, right?
Right.
And inside the booklet, it talks about, shows your designs. And you submitted this, or did you have a design firm put these together?
No. What you do once you do the prior art search, then you're pretty much clear to submit a patent. So once you decide you want to submit a patent, there's something called a provisional patent, which protects you for a year and gets you the status of patent pending.
Okay.
And after that year's up, you can't renew year to year. You have to take the next step and go to a non-provisional patent, which protects you for 20 years.
Okay.
So once you decide you want to do the provisional patent, because that's a good idea, if you have an idea that would be quick to production, you can get the design done quickly and want to try to license it out to somebody. So if you have a company you think that's interested in it, then you can take your idea and be protected while going to them and say, hey, here's my idea, would you be interested in taking this on? Where they could say, hey, we can buy it outright from you, we'd like to license your idea and pay you this much in royalties.
Okay.
So that's an idea for the provisional patent, which lasts a year. And if you want to do some design changes and kind of test it out a little bit more while you can show it to people and feel protected, it gives you time to do that before you file for the non-provisional, which is the big step, the more expensive one that protects you for 20 years.
Okay.
And it's more of a long-term one.
So you've got the last step of it done?
Right. This is a non-provisional. What I did was I went through a provisional patent, and I actually started off with a provisional patent on this.
Okay.
And from there, 6 months later is when we came up with the idea of the disc. So we changed the patent onto the disc.
Okay.
And basically,
so you
switch the whole thing.
You kind of did it.
Right. You can make modifications to it, and then if it modified changes like ours did from one type to another, that other one you can either choose to keep going with it and protect yourself if you think somebody else is going to come up with that. In our case, we didn't feel it was necessary because we achieved what we wanted to with this new design, and so we proceeded with this one.
Cool. All right. And now, is this an expensive process, a patent process? I mean, how much does something like that cost?
You can always do it yourself and save some money. There's filing fees and everything, but I would highly recommend paying a professional to do it, because you're going to be paying these fees anyways, and if you forget a step that a professional knows is a very important step,
mm-hmm.
and you make a mistake and forget one little thing out, then somebody can come in if they see your idea and want to make a change to it. They can go in with your idea, make a little bit of a change to it around a loophole that you weren't familiar with because you're trying to save money up front, but it's going to end up costing you all of
it. So it's best to have the price
in the future. Yeah. That's what I would recommend, just because they know the ins and outs of it in the best types of wording. If you read some of the documentation in here, it's pretty intense for vocabulary and everything.
All right, this is Eric from DriverConnection.com. I'm here with Jason Truda again, and I just want to say thanks for sharing the insight on how your idea came to be, and it was really cool seeing your prototypes. You know, I like to see that kind of stuff, to see where the idea, how it formed. So, you know, obviously a lot of thought went into this and a lot of time and effort went into it. So I really wish you the best of luck. And I hope Chew Tuner gets out there in the drummer's hands so they can kind of see what it's like to have a perfectly clear drum head. So, and again, you can always follow up with iDrumTech after you've swapped your head with the Chew Tuner, and we're trying to work together here and, you know, get you guys some great sounding drums. So I think this is a really cool product. And again, I would not let something happen to my beautiful Danette here without knowing that it's gonna work. And I think Jason's got a great product. So you can find them at truetuner.com. And from time to time, we'll have a special coupon code download, save a little bit of money. And they're also starting to pop up in drum stores, and you can get these things out there and give them a shot. So Jason, man, I really appreciate you having me in your home drum geeking with me here. This has been a lot of fun. And thanks a lot again for sharing your insight to the world of bringing your product to production.
Well, thank you very much for all you do. You've certainly built a great drum community, and you do a lot for all drummers, and we really appreciate it.
Right on, man.
We're all here the same.
Yeah, I love doing this stuff, so I really appreciate it, dude. So you guys check them out, truetuner.com, and consider purchasing one of these things to make your drum heads. And by the way, you know, in this video, we did it slow. You know, you can actually do this in about a minute and a half, depending on how well you get setting up the keys. And it's just like, you know, rudiments, drum solos, riding a bike. Practice it a couple times, and you'll figure this thing out. You'll be flying through your head changes. So I dig it. All right? DriverConnection.com. Thanks a lot.